So hello and welcome to this, the second part in our bite-sized Bible devotional series on Psalm 23. Now hopefully you were with us last week when we began in verse 1. If you haven't had a chance to watch that and to join with that study, please go back first and have a listen to that first, because that will help to set the foundations for what we now look at together. So we pick up in verse 2 and we'll be reading from the New International Version. So the first words that we come across today are, "He makes me lie down." And the use of the language here is perhaps a little strange, a little unusual maybe even, because it implies that somehow God needs to make us lie down, as if it's something that doesn't come naturally to us. I wonder if you might be the kind of person who at times struggles to lie down, struggles to rest even. We can think back, can't we, to the story of Mary and Martha, where one was far more willing to rest and the other had to maintain that sense of busyness all of the time. It's worth having a look through that again at some point in your own time. And I think perhaps the message we can take from that, which applies directly into what we're looking at here, is that sometimes we need to do less for God and do more in the way of receiving from him. To do less, but to receive more. Because we all need rest. Now, our current environment, of course, has very much forced us to be more restful. It means that we've had to put a pause on many things that previously were a big part of our identity. But you know, this has also created an opportunity for us to explore more about who God is, to understand that we can stop, we can be still, and once again reflect on who he is. I wonder how God might be leading you in particular today to a place of rest and what that might look like. Well, as we continue on in our passage, beginning with, "He makes me lie down," we then read, "In green pastures, he leads me beside quiet waters." So that gives us a little picture maybe of the kind of rest that we all need. Now, if you were looking at the beginning of the video, you would have seen a brief walk that I like to take sometimes with the family. And eventually it goes through Sandringham Estate, through the beautiful green woods, and then leads up to a viewpoint which looks out across a long way, even as far as the sea. And I chose that because this is what came to mind as we looked at this part of the passage, of being in green pastures, just that sense of peace that we can get from being in the middle of nature. It's incredible. And we have so many places around us, nearby here, around Dursingham. It really is wonderful. I wonder if you have a favourite green pasture that you like to go to. But you know, for David, who was the writer, we understand, of this psalm, a green pasture was actually something that was very unusual for him to see. It was very uncommon. And green pastures were by no means as abundant as what we experience around us locally here. Instead, for him, his environment as a shepherd would have looked a bit more something like this. You can see it's actually far less about a green environment and more of a desert environment. So then we can read this passage holding in mind that a green pasture is not something that was plentiful, but rather more something like finding water in a desert, or perhaps in our own terms, drinking an ice cold drink on a warm summer's day, something of much needed refreshment. You know, green pastures for David were not just a literal physical thing. What he was meaning here was something deeper. It was, in fact, a spiritual reality. As we finish in the words of our study today, we read, "He restores my soul." Of course, there are many different types of restoration. We have physical restoration, emotional restoration, spiritual restoration, of which are all necessary and important to a thriving and healthy life. But David doesn't say he rests my weary legs or he restores my feelings of happiness. No, he says he restores my soul. The words of the very well-known hymn, it is well with my soul, come to mind, don't they? David is speaking of a deep, deep change within himself. Something that could only come about through God's transformative power at work in his life. And you know, we live in a privileged age because unlike David, we can say that we have seen and experienced the Lord Jesus Christ, who has come down to us, lived among us, eventually died for us, rose again, and then gifted us with the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives to help us follow him in all that we do. When we read the words, he restores my soul, we can now drink from the living waters of Jesus Christ himself to experience our souls being restored. It's a comforting truth that no matter how barren the desert around us, coronavirus or not, God stretches out his hand to give us the refreshment that we need, to give us renewal of our souls. We can find forgiveness in him. We can find rest and restoration in him. Well, that is the end of our study for this week. Hope you've enjoyed it. Please tune in again next week for the next part in our study in verse 3. Thanks very much and goodbye.